Last video, we followed the exploit technique Niklas used in his exploit and crafted this crazy memory layout of effed up objects in memory. And now we use that to create an arbitrary memory read and write primitive. To do this, we need to quickly remember how the victim object looked like in memory. Victim is an array with doubles, so it has a butterfly that contains double array elements. And we must not forget the properties this victim object has. One property was this dynamically created one-to-spray structure IDs, but there's also this .a property. And the reason why we wanted to also set a .a property on victim will be explained now. So in our pretty memory picture, we have victim here. And maybe you remember that we used hex, which has its butterfly pointing to the victim, and access the second element with brackets 1. So hex 1 will actually be this memory cell, the butterfly address of the victim. And we used that to point the victim butterfly to unboxed or boxed before, so screw up their butterfly. Anyway, with hex 1, we can control the butterfly of victim. And we know that victim has a property.a. And we know from examining memory that the property.a is stored in the butterfly, on the left side of the butterfly. So from the point of view of the victim object, if you read or write to the .a property, you follow the butterfly address, go a bit to the left, hex 10 in fact, and this is where you find it. So do you see how you can turn that now into an arbitrary read and write? If you control the address of the butterfly, you can point the butterfly anywhere in memory. And then the .a property allows you to access the memory minus hex 10 from that butterfly address. It's so simple. So an arbitrary read would take an address again as a double value, then we add hex 10 to it because the property will make us access hex 10 subtracted from that address, and then we write that address to the butterfly of victim by assigning it to hex 1. Boom. When we now read the victim property.a, so we return it here, we follow that arbitrary butterfly address, subtract hex 10 to reach the .a property value, and return it. You just built an arbitrary read. And a write is obviously super simple as well. Pause the video and try it yourself. You again take the address you want to write to as a double, add hex 10 to compensate for the minus hex 10 when you access the property, and then simply assign the value you want to write to the property.a. Done. Now, there is one small important detail. So the type of the hex object was crafted by the outer object, which set the hex type to array with contiguous. We did that because we used hex 1 to deal with objects, the unboxed and boxed objects. So we wanted to deal with JS values, and array with contiguous means your array contains JS values, which means your doubles are encoded as JS values. And this will screw up our arbitrary read and write now, because the doubles we use as addresses written to hex 1 would be converted to JS values, meaning they get this huge constant hex 10000 added to it. We could compensate for that by subtracting the value from our target address first, but that would mean we can't write to any address. If the address is below the JS value double start address, we couldn't set it. However, Niklas gets around that by overwriting the JS cell header of the hex object by making it a raw array with doubles. So outer.cellheader will change the type of hex, and if we do that before we create our read and write functions, now our doubles are not getting encoded and stay the same. Let's try it. I'm starting JSC in LLDB again, and I execute our script that we extended with the read and write functions. Okay, so now we need an address that we can read and write with. So let's just create a new empty object, and we can also use the JSC debug function describe x to get the real memory address. But we can also use addressOf to get the address as a double in JavaScript, right? So this double is this address, just in double representation. And now let's read from it. Read 64 addressOf x. So apparently this value here is stored at this address. Let's hit Ctrl C and examine the memory. So that should be the cell header with the structure ID and so forth of the x object. Now let's continue and try to write a value. Let's do something recognizable like hex 41414142424242. We need to get the double representation of that so we can assign 41414141 to U321 and 42424242 to U320. And then we can get the double representation with F640. Cool. So let's do it. Write 64. Where do we want to write? At the address of x. And then what do we want to write? Our new value. Okay, let's try to read again. Okay, so this already looks different. Let's check it out in memory with LLDB. Examine memory. There we go. Boom. We wrote an arbitrary value. And with this, we can basically do anything. For example, we could try to find a stack address and then overwrite values on the stack and hopefully overwrite the return address so that we hijack the execution flow and we could create a ROP chain or something. If we look into Linus's exploit, we see that he has this function fetch an exec, which downloads a binary file and then creates a JIT compiled function because a JIT compiler will have to create executable and writable memory. So he gets that, and using the read and write primitives, he can find the address of this JIT function in memory and then copies this binary he downloaded to that writable and executable memory. And then he executes the JIT compiled function, but the JIT compiled function code was now replaced with the binary he downloaded. So that's a simple but powerful technique to get a second stage shellcode running. Definitely nicer than a ROP chain. But this requires a JIT compiler. Well, the whole bug we abuse requires JIT, but just to provide some context, not every WebKit environment has JIT. For example, the WebKit on the Nintendo Switch does not have JIT. Thus, when those researchers had this WebKit exploit for the Switch, they only could do really annoying ROP chains because there was no JIT for shellcode. Now, that was Linus's exploit. Niklas, on the other hand, does something else. Niklas actually crafts a universal XSS from it. Normally, JavaScript is forbidden to access other websites. So for example, I couldn't have JavaScript on LiveOverflow.com that accesses YouTube.com. Browsers block that because of the same origin policy. But now that we have arbitrary control over the memory, Niklas gets a basic XML HTTP request object, gets its address, traverses a bit the object, and finds the address of the security origin object. And then he apparently overwrites the muniversal access flag and sets it to 1, to enable universal access. Having a quick look into the WebKit source code, we can see that the function canAccess simply returns true when muniversal access is set. This means that when you now try to access other domains, the browser will not block you. The same origin policy is disabled. And in the example, Niklas then injects a JavaScript dynamically into a website that had been iframed earlier, which you normally are not allowed to do. Amazing, right? Now, before we finish this video, I just wanted to emphasize one thing, as some kind of recap of this whole journey. Maybe all of this seems very arbitrary, and it started to feel arbitrary with these weird primitives, fake object and address of. Like, okay, well, Saelo did that, great, what's so special, couldn't we do something else instead? Yes, absolutely, we could do something else, but there is a reason why so many people use it. They turn out to be extremely powerful in practice, and they allow us to easily control the inner structure of JavaScript objects and allowed us to turn them into arbitrary read and writes. I don't have the exploit development experience like others. Maybe there are some super clever people out there that have different techniques or strategies to exploit browsers that are better than address of and fake object, but from my limited perspective, I can totally see why they are so cool. And one more thing. Right now, our exploit is very unstable. As soon as the garbage collector tries to clean up, it will crash because everything is so effed up. So if you put a lot of time and effort into an exploit that is super memory safe, then building it on top of address of and fake object primitives, this work can be reused for the next exploit. If you find the new vulnerability, all you have to do is to create the functions fake object and address of from your bug, and then you just copy and paste all the other code that does the rest of the exploit. Of course, stuff still might change between WebKit versions and the second stages might stop working, but you get the idea why creating these layers of abstractions is very useful. You start with address of and fake object, then you create arbitrary read and write, and then you optionally clean up memory with it, or just continue your exploit, be it a UXSS or some shellcode.